What happened second? Because that's the only thing that we wanted to talk about in this week. But first, a lot of material stuff. We said from the beginning of this debate that we owe a moral duty to recognize individuals of autonomy. This is to give them the right to a vote. This is not about how they use that vote, but in recognition of their autonomy to begin with, that we give them this vote. That's why all of that consequential analysis since first was unresponsive to this. The only response we heard was, but the right to vote is only important if it translates into policies. Wrong. We think that when people choose not to vote, when people cast a blank vote, none of those votes eventually result in the actual policy being passed. But it's still a legitimate political expression, because political belief and what you believe is important to you is just as important to your standard of living, apart from the specific policies you get in terms of economic policies. That was not dealt with. Furthermore, the response you get is our third speaker is that, but look at Venezuela and the shared elections. If there's a shared election, I don't think this is a democracy anymore. In fact, I think Venezuela is more of a socialist benevolent dictator on your side of the house. But the second important principle devoid of outcomes is accountability. And we think that all governments ought to be accountable to their citizens. They say that a single person is more accountable because we know who it is. But here's the problem. When it's a single person, he has the capacity to hide stories. He has the capacity to hide stories about the Tian Anmen massacre, to hide stories about the oppression. And yes, to everyone living within that country, he seems benevolent because he tells them what he does well and never tells them what he does badly. In all of those circumstances, he seems benevolent, but the stories of oppression are kept hidden on your side of the house. That's why we're willing to argue that doing things slower is good. Even if it takes longer for us to craft a policy, we think that these policies are simple decisions that technocratic expertise can answer. We require debate and contesting ideas within the long term. We think that taking longer to come to a solution is something that's far better. And yes, regime change is sometimes part of this process. And it might be unpalatable for me to say that regime change is necessary in some circumstances. But I think it's important for people to test what kind of system they want continuously and arrive at one they can all agree is good for the entire society, compared to a benevolent dictator that superimposes what he thinks is good for that society and tells them that they need to believe in that system. That is why we think it's our side that ensures that people have accountability and the right to vote. This is not engagement. Second area of clash on the material standard of living. All of their harms are contingent on the snapshot of the current system of a weak democracy. But we say that governance is not only about what happens today, but how we prepare for future generations. We say that weak democracies can be strengthened by practicing being a democracy. And this deals with the point about how we're only defending the super stable systems. No, we're not. What we are saying is in the long term, weak democracies can benefit by preserving those democratic institutions. This deals with all of the issues about revolution and regime change. Because we think for the vast majority of people in these societies, they are committed to a democracy. They want to keep these democratic institutions as much as they can. Which means that their first response is unlikely to be revolution, but rather to vote on these areas as well. Furthermore, we need international pressure to preserve the weak democracies higher because democracy in the status quo is currently seen as a priority good, given how the UN is run by certain countries within the world. For all of these reasons, we think that these can improve in the long term. But second of all, every single argument they have about economic growth and social stability is a facade, because something has to give. If everything was so perfect, he would win the election. But he is still censoring the media. He is still curtailing free speech. Why? Because the treatment of minorities are being hurt. How the military junta wanted to improve the economic situation of the Burmans, but this came at the expense of the Kashmiris and the Karens. How Saddam Hussein in Iraq oppressed the political minority of the Shias. On the comparative, we think this is better than a weak democracy. Because even a weak democracy might disenfranchise minorities to some extent. At least they have the right to vote. At least they have the right to run for office. At least they even have a party that represents their interests to begin with. We think this is an important comparative. What we need to remember at a moment is that benevolence is benevolence for the majority. Stability means to sideline minorities even more, making them invisible so that it will never result in instability within your societies.
Sure. So Donald Hussein only rose to power in the first place because of the literal lack of democratic accountability in the weak democracy in Iraq prior to his regime. That's why your side of the house increases all the harms in place that
I think the reason why Saddam Hussein came to power was because he was able to run on the narrative how he would protect his Sunni Muslim majority base at the expense of minorities, the same benevolent dictators you talked about. The response you got from third speaker was that you create a veneer of a solution to a democracy. Here's the thing, when you still have a democracy, observers who come come to see your elections can still come in. International organizations like Amnesty International can still come in. So there's a lot more accountability on that regard. There is no veneer of a solution. This is incredibly important because we owe special moral duties to these minorities. They are the ones that require the vote the most. They are the ones that require representation and democracy the most. It's important that we preserve such a system for them. This also deals with issues about post-conflict states, because it's more likely in a post-conflict state that you can try to superimpose stability at the expense of these minorities to create a facade of stability within the short term, hurting these minorities even more. But here's the last thing. You oppress the freedom of thought. What benevolent dictators do is to craft the definition of what benevolence is. A good example of this is Russia, when Putin says that benevolence is nationalism and military protection compared to economic growth. The problem here is that when you indoctrinate people to believe in what you think is good for them, you will never be able to actually provide what people genuinely want on the ground. This takes them to their highest ground because people can believe that they are being benevolent. People can believe they're doing the right thing. But is that actually what you genuinely want? No, and that's the problem with dictatorship. It is sticky. Even if right now you're benevolent, your capacity to constrain people's thoughts and indoctrinate them within the long term means that when you pass that power to the next person, be it your son or be it someone with political influence and connections with you, that person might have the same interest. And you can use the very same systems you created for your dictatorship to forward his evil agendas. This is why a weak democracy is still a democracy. We are incredibly proud to oppose.